Hello friends, let us now continue our discussion on anesthesia. Okay, in this the airway compromising conditions. If you see in the airway compromising conditions, the first is congenital conditions and we have acquired conditions. So in congenital conditions, we have Pierre-Robin's syndrome. So what does this Pierre-Robin syndrome include? This includes micrognathia, cleft palate and macroglossia. It has micrognathia, cleft palate and macroglossia. So this is the Pierre-Robin syndrome, where if you see here, you see very small chin thin. So this is micrognathia, very small chin. Okay, there is cleft palate, you can see cleft palate here. There is micrognathia, cleft palate, and there will be macroglossia, that is big tongue also. So this is how a Pierre-Robin syndrome patient looks like. Okay, then if you see, the next anomaly is Treacher-Collin syndrome. Okay, what is this Treacher-Collin syndrome? In Treacher-Collin syndrome, the patient will have mandibular and malar hypoplasia. Treacher-Collin syndrome is associated with mandibular and malar hypoplasia. What is Treacher-Collin syndrome here? So this is Treacher-Collin syndrome. See, you can see the mandibular hypoplasia here and even malar hypoplasia this side. Okay, so this is Treacher-Collin syndrome. Okay, where you see mandibular and malar hyperplasia. Then the third syndrome is Goldenherr syndrome. What does Goldenherr syndrome include? This includes ocular and auricular defects. Okay, these include ocular and auricular defects, and these also include mandibular and malar hypoplasia. So these include two things: one, ocular and auricular defects, and these also include mandibular and malar hypoplasia. So if you see here, there is ear defect, and even here there is this side, you see hypoplasia. So this is the Goldenherr syndrome. What is this Goldenherr syndrome? Is this one. Okay, where you see mandibular and malar hypoplasia along with ocular and auricular defects. Then the next syndrome is Down syndrome. So you know Down syndrome, right? That is the reason why I didn't put the picture. So in Down syndrome, you see poorly developed nasal bridge and macroglossia. So what do you see in Down syndrome? We see poor developed nasal bridge and also macroglossia are seen in Down syndrome. Then the next syndrome which we have is Klippel-Feil syndrome. What do you see in this Klippel-Feil syndrome? This Klippel-Feil syndrome, there is congenital fusion of cervical vertebrae. All the cervical vertebrae congenitally, they get fused with each other. That is what you see in Klippel-Feil syndrome. This is Klippel-Feil syndrome. See, congenital vertebrae are fused together. So this is Klippel-Feil syndrome. Right? Next, there is one more syndrome here which is associated with congenital deformities, is congenital goiter causing deviation of trachea. Right? So because of all these features here, there is either the cervical abnormality or abnormality in the mouth, okay, in the the bones which are associated with formation of cheek and chin, and as a result it is difficult for us to intubate during this condition. Okay, those are the congenital defects which are very important, which should be remembered. Then we have acquired defects. So if you see in the acquired defects, these can be seen whenever there is any infection in the oral cavity, or it can be associated with arthritis, most commonly rheumatoid arthritis or ankylosing spondylitis. Then these can also be associated whenever there is tumor in the oral cavity, obesity, acromegaly and acute burns. Okay, so these are the different conditions in which the airway is compromised. Okay, next we will see this other classification. There is something called as Lemon Airway Assessment Method. So what do you see in this Lemon Airway Assessment Method? This is a classification. Lemon is abbreviation. So we have L in the lemon. L for, you will have to look for facial trauma, if there is any facial trauma or large incisors, or if there is any moustache beard, large tongue, any facial feature should be looked, and these were given the point 1. Okay, then we have evaluate 3-3-3-3-3-2 rule. This 3-3-2 rule is really very important. So this 3-3-2 rule tells us that inter-incisor distance. Inter-incisors is 2 incisor tooth. You will have to see the inter-incisor distance, distance between the 2 incisor tooth, and that should be, that is upper incisors and lower incisors. Here 2 incisors matlab. The distance between the upper and lower incisors should be seen, and if this should be more than 3 finger breadth. Okay, and then thyromental distance. In the last class, I have shown you what thyromental distance is, right? That is the, sorry, hyomental distance. That is the distance between the hyoid bone and the mentum. It's called as hyomental distance. So, if this is the mentum, if this is the mentum and you think this is the hyoid bone, so this distance is hyomental distance, which should be 3 finger breadth. Okay, in hyomental distance, it should be 3 finger breadth. And you have thyroid to, this is not thyroid to mouth distance. Actually, this is thyromental distance. Mental distance, okay. Thyromental distance should be through 2 fingertip breadth at least. So from the thyroid cartilage to the mentum, that should be 2 finger breadth. So that is 3-3-2 rule. Okay. Then if you see, you will have to see malampati growth. Sorry, this is thyromental distance, which should be less. Okay. Yeah. Then we have malampati. In the malampati score, if we give 1 point should be given if the score is more than or equal to 4. If the score is more than or equal to 4, then you give 1 point for malampati score. Then we have O for obstruction. Okay, in the obstruction, it can be due to trauma or it can be due to the presence of epiglottis. Okay, whenever there is any obstruction, then that is given 0.1. Then we have neck movement. In neck movement, you will have to ask the person to touch his chin onto the neck. If there is no adequate neck movement, then he could not touch the chin to his neck. So that is neck movement. You should check. Each of them are given 1-1 point each. Okay. And if there is high Lehmann score, then it is difficult to intubate. So we should make sure that the Lehmann score should be less. Okay, so this Lehmann score, what does Lehmann score mean? What is L? L for look for any trauma. And E, what do you see for E? E, you see for, what do you see in E? You will have to evaluate 3-3-2 rule. And we have M for malampati scoring. O for obstruction. Are there any obstruction? And N for neck movements. So all these should be assessed. Then the next grading which is available here is Kornmark-Lehin grading. Okay, what do you see in this Kornmark-Lehin grading? This is also the grading for difficult intubation. Okay, here you have different grades. In the first grade, we call it grade 1. If we are able to visualize the entire laryngeal aperture clearly, then that is grade 1. In grade 2, if only posterior commissure is only visualized, then that is grade 2. In grade 3, if epiglottis is only visualized, then that is grade 3. In grade 4, if soft palate is only visualized, then that is grade 4. So what are they? Grade 1, visualization of entire laryngeal aperture is grade 1. Grade 2, visualization of posterior commissure only is grade 2. Grade 3 is visualization of only epiglottis is grade 3. Grade 4, visualization of soft palate is grade 4. So this is Kornmark-Lehin grading. Okay, now so we have learnt about the complete thing about the different grading systems. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. In the next class, we will learn about anesthesia machine. Thank you.